Kevin, go ahead and call the March meeting of the North Adams Recreation Park District to order. First item on the agenda is the approval of the February 5th minutes. Were there any changes or corrections to those minutes?
Motion to approve is presented.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to second. I guess my only comment was, does Mrs. Monk have a first name?
No, it's not. It's Susan.
Okay, that's fine.
I couldn't remember her name. Oh, my God.
Didn't she sign it?
No, nobody signs in.
She didn't sign in?
I don't know that.
Okay, whatever I can do as chair, she's admonished for the next meeting, so.
Okay.
We have a motion to second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed, abstention, motion passed unanimously. Chairperson's report, I have nothing this month. Comments from board members? Anyone have anything they want to say at this point? Sorry, had a cold. All right, hearing none, I'll go ahead and move on to reports from standing committees. I think we have one under old business. Anything else? All righty, well, next we'll move on to administrator's report. Larry, is there anything you want to add or highlight to your report?
Just want to make a correction on the mid-year budget review. I understated our revenue, so under discussion, you'll see where it's highlighted as revenues. I have it as listed as $682,707. It's actually $784,499.
Wow.
And that would make the unrealized revenue not $643,944, but rather $542,152. Okay. Sorry for that. Okay. And I think that unless the board has any questions.
So was that Terry's fault on the revenue?
No, that was Larry. That was Larry's fault.
Do we have any questions on any Larry's reports? Scott, is there anything you want to highlight or add?
Just my report. Just maybe one quick thing. This week is the CPRS conference being held downtown at the convention center. Mark and I have had the privilege of being able to attend the last 2 days, and then the conference wraps up tomorrow. We really try to divide our attention and go to as many sessions as we can to gather as much information as we can. And I just wanted to thank the board for funding the money and the training budget this year to go to the conference. We get it here in Sacramento every 4 years or so, and it's really a treat to be able to go when it's in your own backyard. So we appreciate the opportunity, just learn an awful lot of stuff, and getting our names and faces out there too, and interacting with our colleagues from not just in the area, but from all over the state is an important factor as well. So we appreciate the opportunity, and maybe we'll give you a more detailed report come up April in our report.
Any questions? Scott? Terry?
No.
Okay, just check. All right. I'm going to take out of order item 10A, new business, SDI Consulting Group, presentation on Community Facilities District. Larry, you want to start this off for us?
Yeah, just briefly, for the last couple of meetings, I've mentioned to the board that part of the process that goes, the financial piece that goes, for us anyhow, that goes with the Silverado Homes development for Elvira. Elvira Park. I sure hope we change the name. I know it's the working title, but that one gets me every time. Is that we have to come up with a process of how we are going to collect funds from the folks who live there to pay for the ongoing maintenance. And so, we don't do that. There's experts out there that specialize in this, and SEI is a firm that specializes in this type of program. So we have contracted with SEI. I should mention that we have Leanne McCabe from SEI here this evening. We also have Brian Spillman from Silverado Homes as well. So it's kind of a three-headed process here. We have the developer, we have the agency, and then we have SEI, who's working with both of us to put everything together. And as Leanne will describe to you, it's a very, very tight timeline once we start.
There's going to be documents and information coming to the board for the foreseeable future, every meeting, resolutions and other types of things that you're going to have to take action on so we can keep the process moving. So rather than me try to tell you something that I'm not an expert at, it's probably best to turn it back over to you, Alan, and then Leanne, so we can let the expert talk about these things. Thank you.
I was planning on having a PowerPoint for you all, but as you may have noticed, I was having some technical difficulties.
That's fine. So we have one. It's just a little paper version.
Exactly. So, like I said, my name is Leanne Cave. I'm with SEI Consulting Group. We've been serving public agencies like yourself for about 30 years, helping them with revenue measures similar to this one. We specialize in feasibility analysis and surveys, revenue measures, which is why I'm here today. We also do stakeholder outreach. We do the annual administration of these special taxes and assessments. We also have other planning services that we do offer. We're located in Fairfield, so we're only 45 minutes away, not too far. So if you want to turn the page to slide 3, this is explaining what a community facilities district is. Formerly, it was enacted by the Mello Roos Act in 1982. And then back in the 90s, there's that Mello Roos started having a negative connotation, particularly in Southern California. So now they're more commonly known as CFDs. Though names can be interchangeable, but like I said, Mello Roos equals angry people, and CFDs is a little more easy to understand. What it does is it's a different financing district that allows special agencies to finance certain services and facilities. It's a little bit more lenient than a benefit assessment or a landscape and lighting district, which you may be familiar with. This is similar, but like I said, much more flexible, and there's different facilities and services that can be maintained with these funds. So next slide. The options, this is just a laundry list of different facility options that different public agencies could use the funds for. In your case, we'll be using it to build parks and recreation facilities. On the next slide is services. And same thing, you'll be using it to maintain park and open space areas, and you can also use it for recreation programs. But with recreation programs, it's a little different. So you can use, for instance, if you have a pottery class, you could use some of the funds to pay for the kiln and the wheel, things like that, but you could not use the funds to pay for the teacher's salary. So it does get a little tricky when it comes to those kind of programs. So next slide. The way that a CFD is set up in the governing document is called a rate and method of apportionment of special tax, commonly known as the RMA. And what that does is it will set up how we will pay, or how different types of properties will pay for their special taxes. This development is planned to just be single family homes, so there won't be too many different options. We may have a section for vacant lots and one for single family homes. We may build in one for commercial just in case something happens, that we have that already in place. We're in the beginning stages of the RMA. We're still waiting on some cost estimates, and once we get those going, we'll be bringing these back to you at your next board meeting in April, so you'll be able to see how we have actually set up that special tax. Another thing is that it really allows a lot for creativity and flexibility. It's not as strict and straightforward as some other funding mechanisms. The CFD and the RMA allows for the district and the developer to really kind of hash out what will work best for both of them. And so there's that component that is really good for districts like yourself. So, next slide.
On that slide there?
Yes, of course.
The third bullet point, what is ad valorem?
Ad valorem is your base property tax. So when you look at your property tax bill, it's that 1%.
Okay.
So the one thing is it cannot be based on is the property value. It can be based on land use size, square footage, lot size, different things like that, but not your assessed value. So moving on. So the CFD election, we will be going through these proceedings. It requires 2/3 support of qualified electors. And in that case, there's two different ways it can be approached. If this was already developed and there were people living there and there were more than 12 registered voters, it would be a registered voter election. In this case, there are not any registered voters living there, so it would be a landowner election. Brian Smellman, the developer, they are the landowners, And so they would be the qualified elector in this case. It's very routine. It's just something that is actually, landowner elections are more common for CFDs than our registered voter ones.
It won't take very long to count the votes.
No, it won't. Won't take very long at all. So, a little bit, I know you guys have been hearing about Alberta Park Development. A little bit about that is, as of now, it's a planned residential development with 225 planned single-family lots. It's located off Alberta Road and Scotland Drive. And you are going to implement this CFD to mainly fund the maintenance of the park within that development, and also some medians and a drainage basin as well. And so those are the cost estimates that we're working on to get this all fair and reasonable. So if you want to go to slide 9, the next steps after this presentation, like Larry said, you will be seeing me pretty often for the next few months. We're going to develop that RMA, and we're also going to adopt local goals and policies. Now what that will do is it'll help it so that way if you would like to do another CFD for another development or even a district-wide one, you'll already have your goals and policies set in place to use going further. And then also we will do the proceedings for the formation of the Community Facilities District. Like Larry said, there are a lot of resolutions. It's just a lot of administrative proceedings. And we'll be here to walk you guys through it the whole way to make it very simple. And then on the last page, we have a tentative timeline for now. It is looking like it's going to be very tight. We could have some flexibility depending on the developer's needs. But right now we're looking at sending out the petition, consent, and waiver form. And what that does is it allows for a smoother and shorter election period. And after that, I will be back here on April 9th. And at that point, you will adopt a resolution of intention to establish this. And I will bring forward the RMA, which will also be adopted, and a description of services and facilities. And then after that, we'll mail the ballots. And then I will be back here again on May 14th. At that time, we will have the ballots collected, and we'll have a public hearing if anyone's here wants to comment on it. And then there's a number of resolutions that will be passed. We will tally the vote, just the one vote from Sterling Meadows, or Silverado. And then at the end, you'll adopt the resolution that will declare the results and direct the recording of notice of special tax lien. And that will conclude the proceedings for the CFD. Any questions?
I have a question for you.
Yes.
On the public hearing, is that public hearing similar to public hearings in the city where it's based on a certain geographic area around the project? It's not district-wide, is it? Or is that on the open right?
Leanne, you might be better to answer.
No, it's normal. The public hearing is for the qualified voters. So when we send out the ballot, there will also be a notice of public hearing that's inviting the electors to come. Normally, the developers aren't here, but Brian seems to be very involved, which is great. He's nearby. So if he has any concerns, that would be his time to speak at the public hearing. Or if there were any residents here.
I got one question for him.
Okay.
So where this tract of land is, right to the west of it, there's another tract of land that's within our park district.
Mm-hmm.
So if in the future, if that gets developed, can that be included in the CFD or would that be a separate CFD?
Either or. You could do both.
All right.
Right now we're setting it up to be just a single
plot.
So since we are in the midst of developing the RMA, it may be something that maybe you wanted to decide on pretty soon here, because that will have an effect on the special tax rate.
Who owns that lot right now? Do we know?
Yeah, sort of.
Well, immediately to the west, there's six separate property owners, 5 acre parcels.
Right.
I know there's two that would like to develop, and the others have considered it in the past.
Okay.
Just by way of experience, what some of the other parks